many people are in anticipation of a kind of apocalypse, a kind of complete breakdown of social institutions and ideals. And I must say to you, the apocalypse is not something which is coming. The apocalypse has arrived in major portions of the planet, and it's only because we live within a bubble of incredible privilege and social insulation that we still have the luxury of anticipating the apocalypse. If you go to Bosnia or Somalia or Peru or much of the third world, then it appears that the apocalypse has already arrived. And I wonder then, what magnitude of responsibility rests upon those of us who still have the luxury of the time and the clarity to think about what can be done to save ourselves and in so doing save the planet. And the conclusion that I've reached, and it's not easily condensed into a bumper sticker, unfortunately, is that we have to, this is something that I evolved in my own personal life, which is when you lose the thread, when you become confused, the best strategy is to think back to the last sane moment that you knew and then act from there. And this is an impulse that affects societies as well as human beings. This year we celebrate the 500th anniversary of the discovery of the new world, our world. Now that was a historical event essentially financed by Italian banking families and the spin-offs of their enterprises. They created a world on the wreckage of the collapse of the medieval Christian eschatology based on classicism. And that model has survived and functioned fairly well up into the 20th century. This is a standard impulse within a society, to go back to an earlier time and to create new models and new institutions based on an ever more ancient past. Now our situation is global and extreme. And so when we reach back into the past for a model, we have to pass over Greece. We have to pass over dynastic Egypt. We have to go back to a time before history, before the fall into hierarchical dominance, before city-states, before slavery, before advanced technology, before agriculture. And when we go that far back into time, we discover a world that until very recently was completely incomprehensible to us, a world that it was thought of as primitive, simplistic, childlike, as late as the 1950s, and for many people, unto this moment. But careful analysis of these aboriginal societies leads to the conclusion that history is a dysfunctional state of some sort. History is an act of brutish insensitivity, only achievable through an act of self-limitation from the demands and the inspiration of nature. And I reach these conclusions basically as a rationalist. I think that, and this is based largely on the content of the psychedelic experiences that I have had and that I have had described to me, not only by Aboriginal people, but by people such as yourselves, apparently there is a great discovery or insight which our culture is deliberately designed to suppress, distort, and ignore. And this is the discovery that nature is some kind of minded entity, that nature is not simply, you know, the random flight of atoms through electromagnetic fields. Nature is not the empty, despiritualized, lumpen matter that we inherit from modern physics, but it is instead a kind of intelligence, a kind of mind. And as long as we were embedded in this mind, as long as we were a part of its purposes and processes, harmony existed on this planet between human beings and the rest of nature, between men and women, between adults and children, and within the human individual. And the reason that this harmony was able to maintain itself for perhaps 25 times the duration of history is because it honored and balanced all the components that created it. Now, in my book, Food of the Gods, I put forth an elaborate reconstruction of evolutionary theory based on the idea that psychedelic compounds, specifically psilocybin, were what kept us in this dynamic balance with the mind behind nature. And I've lectured that often enough to you that I'm going to only indicate it tonight, to your great relief, I'm sure. I've said it often enough that I think we can operate in the light of it as an established possibility or a respectable theory. The question that I'd like to talk to you about tonight is, if that were true, then what does it say for the future? What are we to do? Where are we to seek hope? And what kind of obligation devolves upon each of us? Well, if this is true, that history is a kind of neurosis, a kind of dysfunction based on a broken line of communication into nature, then how can it be repaired? The personal answer is, to my mind, obvious. It's an involvement with Aboriginal peoples and their practices and attitudes. And I'm not talking about drumming here, folks. I'm talking about availing oneself of the pharmacological and psychobotanical doorways that lead in to a feeling-toned relationship with the natural mind. This is actually the matrix out of which consciousness was born. We find our way back to it through the judicious use of psychedelic plants. And I think I have made that point enough times that I don't have to repeat myself. What I'd like to talk about tonight is, how do we, a self-defined cultural elite, as much as anybody hanging out in their office in Century City, how do we, the psychedelically informed postmodern neo-shamanic community, go, move from being a tolerated and somewhat loathsome fringe population to a voice in the dialogue here in anticipation of the end of the world that can be heard? How do we do that? Well, I think that there are a number of possibilities, and I always enjoy making this point in this town particularly, because this is the city of the graven images, not in gold and stone, but in film and light. This is the meme engine of the Western world. Those of you who work in media know the power of the word. As it is said, so shall it be. And so the tool of the revolutionaries at the end of the millennium is, to my mind, art. Art which connects people, which transcends the mundane, and which empowers hope. And, of course, it can have many forms and occur in many media, but it must be true to itself. It must be true to the thing we were before the descent into history.